I was back in the land of the dead, in the Hall of Judgment. The crumbling monuments of a New Orleans graveyard shimmered around me. Spirits of the dead stirred restlessly in the mist. At the base of the broken scales, a tiny monster slept amid the devourer. He opened one glowing yellow eye to study me, and then went back to sleep. Anubis stepped out of the shadows. He was dressed in a black silk suit with his tie unknotted, like he'd just come back from a funeral, or possibly a convention for the really gorgeous undertakers. Sadie, you shouldn't be here. Tell me about it, I said, but I was so glad to see him, I wanted to sob with relief. He took my hand and led me towards the empty black throne. We have lost all balance. The throne cannot be empty. The restoration of Maat must begin here, in this hall. He sounded sad, as if he were asking me to accept something terrible. I didn't understand, but a profound sense of loss crept over me. It's not fair, I said. No, it's not. He squeezed my hand. I'll be here waiting. I'm sorry, Sadie. I truly am. He started to fade. Wait! I tried to hold on to his hand, but he melted into mist along with the graveyard. I found myself back in the throne room of the gods, except it looked like it had been abandoned for centuries. The roof had fallen in, along with half of the columns. The braziers were cold and rusty. The beautiful marble floor was cracked and as dry as a lake bed. Bast stood alone next to the empty throne of Osiris. She gave me a mischievous smile, but seeing her again was almost too painful to bear. "Oh, don't be sad," she chided. "Cats don't do regret." "But aren't you dead?" "That all depends." She gestured around her. "The Duat is in turmoil. The gods have gone too long without a king. If Set doesn't take over, someone else must. The enemy is coming. Don't let me die in vain." "But will you come back?" I asked, my voice breaking. "Please, I never got to say goodbye to you. I can't." "Good luck, Sadie. Keep your claws sharp." Bast vanished, and the scenery changed again. I stood in the Hall of Ages in the first gnome, another empty throne. And Iskar sat at its feet, waiting for a pharaoh who hadn't existed for 2,000 years. "A leader, my dear," he said. "Maat demands a leader." "It's too much," I said. "Too many thrones. You can't accept Carter." "Not alone," Iskandar agreed. "But this is your family's burden. You started the process. The Kanes alone will heal us or destroy us."
"I don't know what you mean."
Iskandar opened his hand, and a flash of light. The scene changed one more time. I was back at the Thames. It must have been the dead of the night, 3 o'clock in the morning, because the embankment was empty. Mist obscured the lights of the city, and the air was wintry. Two people, a man and a woman, stood bundled against the cold, holding hands in front of Cleopatra's needle. At first I thought they were a random couple on a date. Then with a shock I realized I was looking at my parents. My dad lifted his face and scowled at the obelisk. In the dim glow of the street lamps, his features looked like chiseled marble, like the pharaoh statues that he'd loved to study. He did have the face of a king. I thought, proud and handsome. "You're sure?" he asked my mother. "Absolutely sure?" Mum brushed her blonde hair out of her face. She was even more beautiful than her pictures, but she looked worried, eyebrows furrowed, lips pressed together. Like me when I was upset. When I looked in the mirror and tried to convince myself that things weren't so bad. I wanted to call to her, know where I was there, but my voice wouldn't work. "She told me this is where it begins," my mother said. She pulled her black coat around her, and I caught a glimpse of the necklace, the amulet of Isis, my amulet. I stared at it, stunned, but then she pulled her collar closed, and the amulet disappeared. "If we want to defeat the enemy, we must start with the obelisk. We must find out the truth." My father frowned uneasily. He'd drawn a protective circle around them, blue chalk lines on the pavement. When he touched the base of the obelisk, the circle began to glow. "I don't like it," he said. "Why won't you call for our help?" "No," my mother insisted. "I know my limits, Julius. If I tried it again..." My heart skipped a beat. Iskandar's words came back to me. She saw things that made her seek advice from unconventional places. I recognized the look in my mother's eyes, and I knew my mother had communicated with Isis. "Why didn't you tell me?" I wanted to scream. My father summoned his staff and wand. "Ruby, if we fail..."